people come to New York to be stars, but there ain't no stars in the sky. And that's so like it is.
It looks dreamlike, and it has that pristine, crystalline appearance from a distance, as long as you can't see the people. It looks like that deserted city of the Krells in the Forbidden Planet. Stay your distance and be amazed. I find really, very odd about coming to New York is that I could so easily have been an American myself. Not because I feel it in my own temperament, but simply because my own family were immigrants to England. Both my grandfathers were Russian Jews who left Lithuania and the western borders of Poland in the 1860s and took completely haphazard journeys away from Russia, not to anything in particular, but simply away from Russia. And one arrived at Tilbury and the other arrived in Cork City in Ireland. And I'm the result of that haphazard landfall. But quite easily they could have taken another boat and landed up here in New York. So I feel inside my real self there's a phantom version of the American that I might have been.
I was always, no matter where I lived, Chattanooga, Chicago, South Jersey, I was always an outcast. You know, even my own neighborhood, even in my own family, I looked different than my whole family. I always felt alien. Not that I wasn't loved, but the people all thought I was weird looking and skinny and all that. I had an eye patch, which I've since got rid of. When I came, I never had no friends or boyfriends. When I came to the city, my whole life changed.
I first came here now 8 years ago to spy out the land for Beyond the Fringe. I remember I was picked up the first time simply by a very large hired car, and as far as I can remember, by the impresario's right-hand man, who was a man with a chin slightly bluer than any I'd ever seen in London. So there was a faint feeling of being picked up by a gangster organization and brought into New York as an out-of-town torpedo for a contract. The second time I arrived, it was a year later when we actually came to do the show, I came by sea. And by that time, the show had been visited by many Americans who said, "You're coming to Manhattan." I said, "Yes, to New York." And then they said, "You'll have to be very careful. You go out in the streets, you'll be mugged. Mugging takes place a great deal." And this began to incubate in my imagination all through the sea trip. And it gave me 5 sleepless nights. So by the time I arrived in New York and came up the East River on the boat, all I can remember is the tremendous apprehension and anxiety and fear of these muggings that were going to happen. I was convinced that as soon as I stepped off the boat, there'd be large numbers of people in striped jersey and panda masks and swag bags who would instantly hit right over the head. And for the first 2 days, I didn't dare to step outside my hotel. Tremendous feeling that these muggings... And I was never quite sure what a mugging was. It wasn't quite like a beating up or an ordinary robbery that takes place in London. We were all done with a rather sort of gentlemanly highwayman, your money or your life. The very idea of mugging had an idea of some sort of sinister thing half tangled up with a sexual assault. The fact that I was going to be bundled onto the sidewalk and mauled and kissed and fondled in some strange way, as well as being relieved of one's bankroll.
Had good good luck. Because actually, do you ever see a Perot Le Fou where Anna Karina and Belmondo tell stories to make money? Well, I was very good at that. Not so, now I don't know, maybe I've talked myself out, but when I first came, I was so full of life, a real high, happy, high strung, you know, that I did a lot of that. You know, that was the way I got dough, telling little stories, you know, stuff like that. In fact, I met all these rich boys once who I used to meet every day. There were four of them. They were real, real rich boys, the first time I ever knew rich boys, and they didn't touch me or nothing. They didn't act real smart with me. They just sat and I'd tell them stories about this circus I made up, about this tightrope walker. And it was this magical circus of jugglers and magicians and sword swallowers. And they loved it. I was like Wendy with the Lost Boys and all these rich boys in proper suits, like Dorian, young Dorian Grays, you know, getting a little decadence, you know, here and there. And they'd, you know, they'd give me money and junk like that. Met them, you know, every couple days a week. So I was sitting pretty, you know, go see the rich boys.
Absolutely impossible to see this city for the first time, because for a European, it exists and has already been built and has already got its architects in the imagination long before it's actually built in reality, and therefore it's impossible to see it apart from this grid of fantasy and myth which has been built up through postcards and films.
This movie called The Sweet Smell of Success with Tony Curtis. It's like such a dirty cliche movie. I mean, it's such a dumb movie, but it's so great. I mean, it shows all the wicked decadence, you know, and climbing to stardom, everything, all the cliches about New York, you know, that how it destroys a man's soul, you know, pollutes him. But there was these great, it also showed the romance of dirt, you know, the romance, sewer romance, in that Tony Curtis, although he was polluted by the city, he still loved it. He'd go out after like double crossing someone so he could make his rise to stardom. He'd walk out, you know, and the ink rolls would be running from the newspaper, and you know the old guy would be sweeping up something, and a few flashy whores, you know, with real shiny tits and all would walk by. And I remember he inhaled the soot and pollution and said, "I love this dirty city." I said, "Yeah, that's for me."
It's the curious antiquity of New York which is so striking the first time you arrive. You suddenly realize when you do come here that it's a city of the future, but a city of the future as it was conceived by 19th century futurists. It's a Wellesian city of the future, and not, in fact, a Ray Bradbury city of the future. But here, with these sort of huge girders and cantilevers and things, it's like a 19th century Scottish engineer's fantasy of the future. Oh,
books of New York. My whole view of New York was through de Kooning's eyes. You know, and Jackson Pollock. And Franz Klein. So, you know, all the, you know, the way I thought of New York in my head wasn't any glitter or big buildings or promise of anything. To me, it was a slash of like dirty grayish pink, you know, like representing the side of a building. And then Jackson Pollock, if he did a painting of New York, it was filled with, you know, all that nervous energy and all that. So my view of New York was abstract, but it was abstract. It was dirty abstract. It wasn't abstract in the clouds. It was abstract in the street. So, and also, even Modrian, you know, Broadway boogie woogie. I didn't know what to expect from Broadway except flashing lights, you know, through Modrian's painting, you know, because he does tink, 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 looks like. And that's what I thought Broadway to be.
Of course, always in the background, there's that feeling of the city as the city in The Wizard of Oz, a rather distant mineral metropolis in which all sorts of obscure gratifications are going to be received, strange rewards and curious penalties. One will get back one's heart or one's intelligence. Or the idea of the city as a mecca to which you come in order to repair yourself and become superb.
Inside myself here, because it let me. When I lived in Chattanooga, man, or South Jersey or whatever, there was no time for daydreaming. I mean, life was simpler there. Life was simpler because, you know, we worked, we slopped the hogs, you know, we picked the peaches and all that stuff, and then you came in and you ate your supper and you thanked the Lord and then you went to bed. It was real simple. You weren't hassled, you didn't have people trying to hold you up or goose you and stuff like that. But that's all there was. There was no chance for extension. There was no chance to be destroyed or really be created there. Just lived. And that's okay for some people, but I always felt something different stirring in me. And that's what, that's like why I came here. Because I knew there was stuff inside me that could like flower. Maybe it would really ruin me. Maybe I'd feel really shitty about it, but at least it would come out. There's no place for it to surface. I mean, you know, there's only so far you can daydream when you're slopping a hog.
Well, this is the Broadway that I really know. It's much further uptown than the Broadway that's famous, much further uptown than the Theatre Broadway. And this is the place where I first came to live when I arrived in New York about 8 or 9 years ago. And this little triangle here, Verde Square, strange, sad, melancholy, run-down district, seems somehow to advertise bereavement and widowhood. When the sun comes out, this whole place is filled with little tiny Jewish widows sitting in Persian lamb coats, sunning themselves under the pigeons here. It's a strange atmosphere, really, of Vienna, of the third man. You half expect to see the cruising jeeps of the four-power commission here. And there's a great decaying Nymphenburg hotel there called the Ansonia, full of rather curious people, sad widowers living there. And it has gymnasiums and weight-reducing salons and supermarkets. It's altogether a much more European part of New York, this.
This is the first place I came to in New York, was the Chelsea Hotel, because Dylan Thomas, like, was one of my big heroes. And so, like, Dylan Thomas used to hang out on this very roof. And I'm sure, like, he threw up a couple, one too many rums or something off this roof. Looked at the old Empire State Building right here. And I've always, like, liked to be where the big guys were, you know.
Stormy days of fear, all our fighters walking on, all the fighters walking on, all our children's very brave. Move, Ballard!
the man cigarette.
Well, we arrived here in 1962 having not the faintest idea what sort of reception we would get.
We never had the applause and we never had the reception backstage that everyone says happens to a successful show. Everyone said there'd be thousands of girls backstage and there'd be enormous lines of fans. And we used to emerge from our dressing rooms and thrust open the stage door in the expectation of autograph hunters and fans and girls fainting. But all that we had was a very faithful retinue, which consisted of three people who used to appear every day, and particularly on matinee days. It was a little girl of 14 from New Jersey called Suzanne Murray, and her friend, who looked like the Bistow kid, a strange, starveling girl, hand planted on her chest with admiration, and a four-year-old brother. And the only sign of admiration or approval we got was as we emerged from the doorway of the Golden Theatre and turned the corner, the brother emptied his bowels in appreciation. And this happened regularly, like clockwork, every time. The only other fan, I think, that we ever had was one that appeared about once a week and sat in the front row of the stalls and used to send me strange billet doux on scented notepaper. And I could see her down there, submerged like a puffer fish at the bottom of the shallow water in the stalls, breathing slightly, a thin chain of bubbles coming from her gills, watching my performance. And I'd become so hypnotized by this girl, it would slow me up and I wouldn't know what I was doing at all.
How long have you been collecting autographs?
15 years.
Really? What do you do with them?
Save them. It's a hobby.
Really?
Yeah.
How many have you got now?
1,100.
Really?
Yes.
I think you once got mine a long time ago.
Yes, I think I did.
But that was 8 years ago. Do you remember a show called Beyond the Fringe?
Oh, yes. You're Jonathan Miller?
That's right, yeah.
Yes, I got yours.
Did you ever see a show I was in here?
No.
It was an English show, a review, called Beyond the Fringe.
Oh, yes. Yes, I saw Beyond the Fringe.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, that's a show that's been for a long, long time.
That was 8 years ago.
That's right.
How did you like it?
Oh, it was very good.
It made you laugh, did it?
Yeah, very good. Very good. I see everything. He's taking my picture. I bet you'll be in the news. I wouldn't be a bit surprised. I bet you'll be in the news. Okay.
Bye.
So long.
Goodbye.
Look at that. Isn't that cool? I love that where, like, kids write all over the walls. That, to me, is neater than any art sometimes. Jose and Maria forever.
Right here?
Tina and Louise. Yeah, right here. Right up there is where the theater is. It says St. Clement's.
Where's the logo?
Yeah, it's right there. Look, the people on the street are so neat. You know, they're, like, so... like warm and like regular people. And just a few blocks up is like total plastic Park Avenue. Yeah. Really cool thing happened when we were doing our play. There was a play going on before us and I came in and it was like 5 minutes before I went on, I was late. And the people stopped me and said, oh, there's a terrible audience. It's awful, it's all the street kids. Oh, it's disgusting. They're all yelling and hooping. It's like a roller derby. I said, that's my style. And you know, that's like, they didn't even understand it. It was a fantastic audience, you know, because they didn't just sit there, you know, like this, you know, watch the theater. They were cheering, you know. When I was sad, they'd go, ah, oh, you know, when I was mad, they'd go, hit them, like this. It was really great. I used to read rock and roll magazines all the time, you know, and just like, I just like learned all about my guys, you know, all about Buddy Holly or whoever from a rock and roll magazine. Then when I came to New York, I started writing for rock and roll magazines. And it's such a strange feeling. You feel like something's lost, you know. Now I can't look at a rock and roll magazine with the same excitement because I can write for anyone I want, you know. So So you lose something. If when you go from being the one who went like this in front of the stage to the person on the stage, you lose that excitement of being a spectator, you know? Because there's a certain... there's excitement on both sides, you know? And being a spectator, you can never have the powerful feeling you feel on stage. You know, so that's... I'm going through that right now. Well, everybody has to go through it when you go from one to the other. You have to transcend the excitement of waiting for the curtain to open when you're in front of the curtain to, like, the surge of power you feel when people are applauding for you. Man, what a great feeling. I have to admit, it's even better than being with a man. It's almost better than that. When people, like, stand up and cheer for you, it's, like, so moving. Because I'm a real hammer.
The odd thing about coming to New York is that if you ever enter it in the first place in a showbiz context, every time you return here, you feel that you have to somehow establish your identity in showbiz terms. If you haven't got some product which you bring with you, if you're not doing something, if you haven't got a show on, if you haven't got something which you've got to mount here, you almost have no identity at all. And you find that you become almost transparent. Every office you visit, somehow you have to make gestures and indicate that you've got something to sell. If you haven't got that, they're not interested in you at all. I find that every time I come here, I simply have to return and see my agent in order to prove to myself that I exist. It's almost as if you somehow begin to believe that you're only an idea in the mind of your agent, and a fading one at that. Perhaps I could make that into a project. Perhaps I could go to my agent and say,
I have this project for a fire in the Sherry Netherlands, Dave. I think we're much into fires now. I think the American public is ready for that, fires in the roofs of hotels. We can get that on CBS. I think that I think it's a very viable project.
You do serve several masters. I mean, you're vitally interested in theater, and you do need time for yourself to do the things that feed the inner man, the inner Jonathan.
But I find I got so exhausted for sort of a year and a half trying to put a film project together, having these enormously exhausting weight-reducing luncheons at Les Ambassadeurs, and everyone saying, well, we're very excited by this project. We'd love to get into the whole zany area, or we'd love to get into the whole costume area. Just at that moment, the excitement fades because the bottom drops out of the market, or the osmosis starts to falter.
Well, I think I can coin a phrase that times may very well be in joint to do it now, yes.
So dirty, it's so trashy. But I mean, I couldn't believe it. I mean, the most glitter I had seen was like the dawn on the swamp, you know?
But one thing was, when you find a little character...
This guy back here has a Rip Van Winkle fantasy. In fact, it's really ironic that he's here because the first time I came to New York, he stopped me and said, I'm going to put you in my Rip Van Winkle movie. And I went, oh, rocket to stardom. And he's, you know, he lives, I mean, his camera is same as that, air. And I was real excited. And then he took me around in Horn and Harris and stuff and camerized me, filmed me with nothing. And I just played along. I figured, what the hell? You know, it was like really getting my picture taken, you know. But he would never even remember me. It's like he's out of his family. Evangelist.
The Lord is God, the Lord is one. When you have trouble with your bosses, remember one thing. There's one big boss for all of us, Almighty God. And tell your little boss to leave you alone, because the big boss created some black, some white, some red, and that's the way he wants it.
I know what I used to come for. I didn't have any dough. Maybe I'd have 50 cents. So 50 cents on 42nd Street can be there all day. You can hang out in Playland, watch the real slick dudes shoot pinball. You can go in the record shops and listen to a whole bunch of neat music before you're thrown out. Eat a 10-cent hot dog. Maybe see something like this going on. There's a lot of things like when you pass by big movie houses, maybe we'll find one. But they have little movie screens where you can see clips of like Z or something like that. People watch it over and over. I've seen people, I've checked them out all day. I've gone back and forth and they're still there watching the credits of a movie because they don't have enough dough, but it's some entertainment, you know. And then they like clock it and then they start saying the dialogue with the guy. You know, when the guy goes, "Don't touch me," they all go, "Don't touch me." It's this little tiny theater. It's greater than anything I've ever seen in a theater.
Girl Dowd, Honeymoon Hotel.
We have a baby on the program, lying in the prone position on the table.
The baby belongs to Viva Superstar. The reason I'm sounding British is because Jonathan Miller is also with us, and he of Beyond the Fringe and so many other great things.
This message, sponsored by the United States Army.
He's the man who's first to answer. He's the man who's met the test. He's today's Army soldier, proud to serve among the best.
Yes, I'm being drafted.
If you'd like to serve among the best, today's Army wants to join you. For the location of your nearest Army representative, call 800-243-6000 toll-free.
Jonathan Miller has been variously described as a zombie, a capricious camel, an elderly horse bewildered at discovering...
Elderly?
That's what it says.
As a horse, elderly. Oh, a horse.
Yes, or a unicorn with a hornet's nest caught on its horn. And five, England's funniest comedian. That's the most difficult one.
It's much easier being a unicorn with five legs.
Yes. Right, well, to help point out how really funny you are, let me play this cut from Beyond the Fringe, which you had absolutely nothing to do.
The great train robbery of over £3 million continues to baffle the British police.
Good evening.
However, we have here with us in the studio this evening the deputy head of New Scotland Yard, Arthur Gaffer.
Good evening.
And I'm going to ask him just a few questions about the train robbery.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir Arthur.
Good evening.
I'm going to ask you just a few questions about the train robbery, if I may.
Good evening. Well, I'd like to make one thing quite clear at the outset. When you speak of a train robbery, this in fact involved no loss of train.
This is Earl Dowd. We are on WOR. And right now, my good friend Lester Smith is coming on with the latest news on this your station for news, which is again WOR 710 on your AM dial in New York.
In a way, entertainment and showbiz become the master metaphor of achievement or failure. The city's character is entirely determined by the state of one's own achievement inside it. It doesn't seem to have any character of its own at all. It's so provisional, the buildings are so temporary, life is so transient, failure so obvious, that if your mood is bad, the city is vile and dangerous and risky. And if your mood is good and you're on the top of a wave, it seems like a crystal city.
Come here, you know, and they don't have, like, I guess I'm lucky because I have a backlog of, you know, of whatever it is, whether it's called art or anything. But New York is a place where you don't have to be an artist to make it, you know. You can make it being a personality. So some people who are crazed for, like, making it somehow will let themselves be turned into anything. You know, it's almost like in the old days, you know, where, like, Marilyn Monroe or Greta Garbo comes in like a fat, young, wide-eyed girl and becomes, well, they make her all up into something else. It's really what happens. A boy with like a strange, who is like sort of has a funny feeling about his sexuality, doesn't know where he's at, will like let himself be turned into like you know, a glamorous Jean Harlow transvestite. You know, and he's used for a while, and everybody throws him flowers and takes photographs and stuff like that. Maybe it lasts for about 3 weeks, and then they're just left. And they're left with, like, this, you know, really tawdry, sequined outfit that doesn't look so hot in the daytime, you know, and all this makeup and a few clip-ins, you know. And it sounds real corny, but that's how it goes. And I don't want none of that stuff to happen to me. But that's like how you have to learn all the rhythms of the city. You have to know that out front. Trip, and there was, I was sitting like this, and I was hoping people would think I was a boy so nobody would try to pick me up. I was real skinny, and I'm going like this, acting like I was a boy. Little did I know the place was filled with faggots.
I find it, there's something very reassuring about going to a pornographic movie late at night, partly because you feel you are at the, at moral rock bottom, that you're at sea level, you can't fall any further. And that here in that reassuring passivity of the rest of the audience, it's impossible to fall any further. And you sit there like strange molluscan creatures at the bottom of the sea, awful, sessile anemones, just gulping this peculiar visual food. But I mean, looking at those films, one begins to realize what a sort of poor, punctured creature man is. Watch these frightful, ragged holes and awful, flabby, varicose organs and intrusions and the hideous effort to maintain some sort of stiff upper lip. And when you sit in a pornographic film, you begin to realize that, in fact, hell is not a punishment for an illicit pleasure. It's the pleasure and the punishment, one and the same thing. And that if there is such a place as hell, it will be a place in which one is simply condemned to enjoy the pleasures which one supposed were pleasures forever and ever until one is exposed to the ultimate stultifying boredom and degradation of the actual act of participation. It's almost as if on the last judgment day we will each of us be summoned and said, you enjoy that activity? Right, you will continue it now and forever. And your punishment will be to experience its degrading and endless pleasure.
Start acting mean. In the summer, New York people start, you know it's summer because they don't smile too much and they always got little beads coming down. And the kids are always fighting. Did you notice like it's never night here? And I was used to like real blackness at night, great big stars. And I lived in the city and I haven't seen a constellation since. Nights never look real here to me. Fall's the neatest time in New York, though, because it's so nostalgic. Kids running, you know, with, like, bags behind them, you know. Fall's like a running time. People are always running after their hats and junk. Little bit of wind between buildings. Everything is so still in the summer. The city's real still, and everything looks foamy. It's real weird, like it's so hot and quiet and there's not too many people out, and the buildings look so sharp against the sky, it looks like you never expect stuff to look like a postcard. And when it does, it really makes you feel weird, you know?
The presence of nature in America is daunting and frightening. There really seems to be no interval between rocks and minerals and Indians and huge, giant cities like this. I'd been living in Manhattan about a year before I discovered the Museum of Natural History. When you live on the island itself, it's really rather like being under some form of luxurious house arrest, and you somehow feel that you'll never see the rest of America at all. And it wasn't until I came here that I discovered that I could visit the rest of America without ever going there. Because inside the museum here, they have the most amazing dioramas of every part of America and every part of the world. And I began to discover, in fact, that if you look at these dioramas, they're perhaps one of the most characteristic forms of indigenous American art. They're the most meticulous recreations of reality that you'll see anywhere outside a photograph. I've always been frightened of the wilder reaches of nature itself. I've always been frightened of going into the wild, frightened of being mugged by wild animals or mugged by mosquitoes. And as I began to take my children to these dioramas on the weekend, I began to think that it might be possible even to spend one's long vacations in a deck chair alongside one of these dioramas, with all the spectacle and all the grandeur, but without any of the risks of being stung or eaten or bitten.
It changes every day. You know, one day it's like Paris too. One day there's a romantic little back street, and the next day it becomes a death yard for tractors and all that kind of stuff. Well, you have to be able to accept that. You know, or you can't get destroyed by change here, and you can't get destroyed with the changes inside yourself. Washington Square was such a piece of poetry. You know, it was like. And it was always the same since Henry James, and, you know, it was like one of my favorite places of the city. I went to Paris, missed Washington Square terribly, came back. I was only gone for like about 5 months. Came back and they had dug it up. There were tractors everywhere. I said, like, what happened? And it's totally changed. It changed right before my eyes. I couldn't believe it. You know, and I know I'm the one who always says you have to accept change. I'm still just getting used to it. You know, you should, because old photographs might mean 6 months ago. I feel that's the charm of New York, you know. I've tried, whenever I go to Europe, I'm like I feel like a travel agent for my city. And I tell them, I say, if you're going to go to New York, please understand, you know, that part of its beauty is like the ugly, horrible shit you're going to see. And part of it, you're not going to see such a innocent decadence any other place in the world. Because, you know, Americans aren't really decadent. They don't know how to be decadent. Their decadence is all visual. That's why I fell in love with the city. I'd never seen such filth and horror in my life. But I absolutely fell in love with that. It's, to me, it's so touching that it could, that it can exist. It can keep existing, you know. It just destroy and create. Just like the Hudson River floats on, doesn't bother anybody. Sure, it's filled with dead dogs and all that kind of stuff, but it doesn't bother anybody, it just flows on.
It somehow was made to be destroyed and reconstructed. You almost feel as if the whole purpose of New York was to examine what it is to be New York by destroying itself periodically. And in returning to a city of this sort and recovering the wreckage of an ancient glamour, one really comes face to face with a much more pressing sense of squalor and decay of oneself as much as of the city around one. And maybe I am mistaken this time, but New York does seem uglier and faster and nastier. Possibly if I came over here,
and was directing a play and was being very well paid, all that ugliness would suddenly recede again, and the thing would once again seem to be invested with a mysterious glamour, and all the dirt and the grit and the danger would vanish.
You have to have a dream, but it's not, you have to be also willing to reshape it all the time. You have to be able to reshape it in what's out there. You have to go in the new beauty, you know? New York is the thing that seduced me. New York is the thing that formed me. New York is the thing that deformed me. New York is the thing that perverted me. New York is the thing that converted me. And New York's the thing I love, too. Yeah, it's my little prayer for New York.
I mean, here I felt heavier and sweatier, and my armpits have been nastier than they've been for years. Frightful wafts of hamburgers and fried frankfurters have oozed out of my clothes as I've undressed in the Algonquin Hotel. Whereas there have been times here when, you know, like Father Zossimer, as it was imagined, you remember that wonderful thing about Zossimer, in that he was going to be fragrant when he died, and he stank, in fact. Well, I always remember that in the past, when I was here, I've smelt great.